In this lecture, I will define some basic elements of the finite difference method. So before we begin, it is important to note that all conservation equations have a similar form, or all conservation equations in fluid mechanics and heat transfer have a similar form, and they can be regarded as a special case of this generic transport equation. So the generic equation that we would see will be for a given variable phi that we want to calculate. The generic transport equation will actually be in terms of that, for that variable phi, would be written in terms of a transient term with a convective term and a diffusive term and a source term. So we'll be solving, or we'll be deriving methods in this lecture series to solve this equation using different methods or using different techniques in the finite difference method. Now the first step of a finite difference method is to define a locally structured grid. That would be the first step that we'll encounter. And what I mean by locally structured grid is that there are certain properties of this grid that need to be followed. The first important property that we need to understand is that the grid lines, or any two grid lines, will not and which belong to the same family, so let's say this family belongs to maybe the xi1 coordinate, that they do not intersect. So a family of lines should not intersect each other. And the second property that we would see is that a pair of grid lines of different families intersect only once. So any pair of grid lines, say we say it's a xi1 constant and the second pair could be xi2 constant, they intersect only once. So what it means is, if I look at examples of this type of grid, two examples could be, let's say if we do in 2D, we can have a grid type which looks something like this. So the two families, the vertical and the horizontal lines, only intersect once, and the points of intersection become the grid points of this grid. Now more importantly, these families need not be orthogonal to each other. So we can also have a scenario where the pair of grid lines could be at an angle to each other, but they still intersect only once. So this is also allowed. And these are examples of two-dimensional structured grids. So this is 2D, or examples in 2D. In 1D, it's fairly simple. We have a straight line and we have grid points, which I can define as spaced at a certain distance. So we can say grid points I, I plus 1, I minus 1, that would be the numbering that I would be using. And this is an example of 1D structured grid. So the idea is that each node will be defined by a set of indices, which I can say in 1D is defined by only one index, let's say I. In 2D, it will be defined by maybe I, j. And in 3D, it could be I, j, k. Now at each point of this grid, we have one unknown variable, which is, let's say, phi. And each node must provide one equation, one algebraic equation for this variable. So how do we obtain these algebraic equations, considering that we are starting with a differential equation? So the idea behind the finite difference method is to approximate derivatives. And the derivatives are approximated based on the definition, or the calculus definition, of a derivative. So for instance, if I want to calculate d phi dx, so the first derivative of a variable phi, at some point, let's say xi. In calculus, we know we can write this as limit of delta x going to 0, phi of xi plus delta x minus phi of xi by delta x. So what does this mean? Geometrically, this is actually calculating the slope of the tangent at xi or at position xi. So if I look at this kind of a function, let's say we have a function phi and we have the x-axis on the lower side. If the function phi goes something like, let's say this, and you want to calculate the slope at some point, let's say xi, and I take two points, let's say in the neighborhood, okay, just to make a point, just to make a clarification here. So let's say I take one point here, this I can say is xi minus 1, and let me take a point here which is xi plus 1, and the distances need not be the same, so I'm going to denote this distance as delta xi and this distance as delta x I plus 1. So geometrically what we're doing is that we're trying to calculate the slope at this location. And so how are we doing this? If you think of it, if the exact slope which I could represent is given by, let's say this line, okay, this is the exact slope, we are approximating in finite difference this slope by an equivalent expression. And the way we are doing it is that we can say that we are going to calculate the slope based on, let's say, two points to start off. And let's say the two points could be, I could take one point here, the other point here, and I could join these two points, and that would be the slope of my function when I use what is called as a forward difference approach. Which is the same as what I've written here. So I calculate the function value at the next point minus the function value at that point by the distance between the two points. The other option could be that I could use the values from, to calculate the slope, I could use this value and the value before it, or at a discrete location before it. So let me take one more example here. If I do that, what we'll get is a slope of this type. This I would call as a backward difference approach. Finally, we can also have a third option available to us, that instead of using this or backward or forward difference, I could actually use the adjacent points at, you know, points adjacent to xi to estimate the slope. And that would actually mean I could do something like use the two points to estimate the slope, and which we call as central difference. So the slope could be estimated by different ways. I've shown you three ways here, and clearly some approximations are going to be better than others. Okay, and but the key idea is that the quality of the approximation will get better as the neighboring points, as points xi plus 1 or xi minus 1 get closer and closer to xi, which basically means that the separations become smaller and smaller. Now, in finite difference, we use a Taylor series expansion to approximate derivatives. And so let's look at the role of the Taylor series in getting these approximations. So let's say for a continuous differentiable function phi of x, and so we'll start with the 1D form. For a continuous function phi of x, in the vicinity of point xi, I could write phi of xi plus delta x in Taylor series as phi of xi plus delta x d phi dx evaluated at point I plus, let's say, delta x square by 2 factorial d 2 phi dx square evaluated at point I plus delta x cube by 3 factorial d 3 phi dx cube at I plus, let's say, general term would be delta x n by n factorial dn phi dxn at I plus some higher order terms. Now, using this expression, I can actually write that d phi dx at location I is the same as phi at I plus 1 minus phi at I by delta x minus delta x by 2 d2 phi dx square at I minus delta x square by 6 d3 phi dx cube at I, and let's say plus higher order terms. So h are all higher order terms which contain higher derivatives and higher powers of delta x. And the notation I've used here is that I'm going to write phi xi plus delta x to be phi I plus 1 and phi of xi to be phi I, and similarly I can say phi of xi minus delta x will be phi of I minus 1. Okay, so now if the distance delta x is small, if delta x was small, then I can easily see here that the higher order terms, or in the limit that delta x is going to 0, the higher order terms will actually vanish, or they will start becoming smaller and smaller. But since we are doing a discrete calculation, delta x is not going to be 0. And so what we are going to assume is that these higher order derivatives are locally very small. And so when they multiply with the smaller number, they actually become, their contribution to the overall derivative calculation is small. So now we can approximate our derivatives in the following way. We could say d phi dx at location I could be written as phi I plus 1 minus phi I by delta x, which I said was the forward difference approach. Or the forward difference scheme. So let me say this is FDS. The second way we could do is we could write d phi dx at I to be phi I minus phi I minus 1 by delta x, and this I can simply obtain by going back to the Taylor series, but writing this time Taylor series of phi xi minus delta x, so at phi of xi minus 1. So we'll get this expression, which would be what we call as backward difference scheme. Okay, so we'll say BDS. Or there could be another option. A third option could be that we could write d phi dx at I to be phi I plus 1 minus phi I minus 1 by 2 delta x. We're assuming that I'm assuming here that delta x I is equal to delta x I plus 1. And this will be the central difference scheme. So when making this approximation, we have removed some terms, or we have sort of, you know, ignored certain terms. The terms that we have ignored are what are called as truncation errors. Okay, so these are truncation errors, which are terms that have been ignored. And these truncation error, or these truncation terms, are a measure of the approximations, a measure of the accuracy of the approximation. So these are measure of the accuracy. Accuracy of approximation. In particular, the first truncated term, or because it's going to be, as I'll show you, the truncation error. Let me write this first. The truncation error that I have not shown here could be written as, let's say, epsilon t to be delta x to the power m alpha m plus 1 plus delta x to the power m plus 1 alpha m plus 2 plus dot dot dot, where alphas are basically higher order derivatives and they contain some, they're just not higher order derivatives, but they also have some constants which I have absorbed in those derivatives. So let's say multiplied by constants. So the truncation error, typically the first term in the truncation error, which I'm showing here as this one, is actually the principal source of error, because for small delta x this will be the largest out of all expression of all the contributions. Okay, and as delta x becomes smaller and smaller, the higher order terms become even smaller. So the principal source of error is this first term. This is the principal source of error in our approximation. Now these expressions that I have shown here for you, this back, forward, backward and central, of course forward and backward are simple because they just need 2 points. The central difference scheme can also be generalized for a non-uniform grid. I have assumed a uniform grid here. If you notice, I have assumed that the grid is uniform or the spacing is uniform on either end, but we can also generalize for higher, for non-uniform grids, and that is not very difficult. But the idea is that this, that the expressions can actually be obtained approximating slopes for using finite difference method, using Taylor series. Now it's, the method is not just limited to slopes, we can also calculate higher order derivatives. So let's consider that we need d2 phi dx square at some location I. So how would we go about doing this? It's fairly simple. Let's start again with Taylor series. So I can write phi of xi plus delta x, which I'm going to write as phi of I plus 1, to be phi of I plus delta x d phi dx I plus delta x square by 2 factorial d2 phi dx square at I plus delta x cube by 3 factorial d3 phi dx cube at I plus 1 by 4 factorial delta x 4, and we'll have d4 phi dx 4 plus higher order terms. Let's say this is equation A, and I can write a similar expression for phi of xi minus delta x, which I'm going to write as phi I minus 1, which would be phi I minus delta x d phi dx I plus delta x square by 2 factorial d2 phi dx square at I minus delta x cube by 3 factorial d3 phi dx cube at I plus 1 by 4 factorial delta x to the power 4 d4 phi dx4 at I plus higher order terms. So let's say this is equation B. Now I can approximate, or I can get an approximation for the second derivative if I add these two equations. Now the thing to notice is that if I add these two equations, I can actually eliminate all odd derivatives of the function phi. So if I add, these two will go out. Similarly, these two derivatives will actually go out, and so all odd derivatives will cancel or will drop. So what we'll get is phi I plus 1 plus phi I minus 1 will be 2 times phi I plus 1 by 2 factorial delta x square d2 phi dx square at I. Then we'll have a delta x 4 d 4 phi dx 4 at I, and let me say whatever higher order terms are there in the expression. And now I can actually rearrange. So we'll rearrange and get d2 phi dx square at the point I would be phi I plus 1. So I'm just going to take everything to the left hand side, minus 2 phi I plus phi I minus 1, divide the whole thing by delta x square. Note that this 2 will actually cancel with this 2 factorial, and minus 1 by 12 delta x to the power square, because once I divide by delta x square, this delta x 4 will become delta x square into d4 phi dx 4 I plus whatever are higher order terms. And so now I have a basis for my approximation. I can now approximate d2 phi dx square at a location I to be phi I plus 1 minus 2 phi I plus phi I minus 1 by delta x square, where I can say that the truncation error, which I'm going to call as TE, is of order, O means order, delta x square. Just because the leading term in the truncation error has a delta x square order. So this is what is called as a second order, because the number here is 2. So second order central difference scheme for the second derivative. So why is it called central difference? Because we took points on either side of the location I to derive this approximation. Now, similar to forward difference scheme, one can also derive second and higher order schemes for the first derivative. What we did in the forward first order scheme here, if you now look at this, the first expression, you will notice that this has a truncation error of order delta x. So I can, it's not that the scheme is limited to order delta x, we can even go higher order. Okay, but going to higher order requires a few more conditions to be able to eliminate those leading terms in the truncation series. So let me show you one way of doing this. So let's say we want to get, let's say the objective is to derive a second order scheme, or I should say forward difference scheme, second order forward difference scheme. Forward mean that we'll have to go only forward of point I for, let's say, the first derivative, let's say d phi dx. So let's take our grid. Let's say we have a grid and we are at some point I. Forward means we have to go ahead. So let's just take points I plus 1 and I plus 2. And let's for now assume that the spacing is the same between points. So we can now write Taylor series. I can write phi I plus 1 to be phi I plus delta x d phi dx at I plus delta x square by 2 factorial d2 phi dx square I plus delta x cube by 3 factorial d3 phi dx cube at I plus higher order terms. Let's say this is equation C. And let me also write what would be phi I plus 2 in terms of phi I. So I can say this is phi I plus 2 is phi I, plus now the spacing becomes 2 delta x d phi dx at I. So what I mean is I'm writing phi I plus 2 in terms of phi I, so the spacing is 2 delta x plus 4 delta x square by 2 factorial d 2 phi dx square at I plus 8 delta x cube by 3 factorial d 3 phi dx cube at I plus higher order terms. Say this is d. So remember, I'm saying I need a second order scheme for the first derivative. So I need to retain these terms. But to obtain second order, it would mean that I will have to divide the whole equation by delta x. So I need to eliminate this expression, but retain this, because that will give me delta x square. That would be second order scheme. So what I can do is, but just by observation here, if I multiply the first equation by 4, which will actually give me a 4 here now in this point, and then subtract from this, so subtract d from c by multiplying the first equation by 4, I can actually eliminate the second derivative. So let's do this. So we get 4 phi I plus 1 minus phi I plus 2 will be, now we'll have 4 phi I minus phi I, that would be 3 phi I. We'll have 4 delta x minus 2 delta x, so that becomes 2 delta x d2 phi dx square at I. The next term will definitely cancel, and then we'll have 4 delta x cube by 3 factorial minus 8 delta x cube by 3 factorial, that becomes minus 4 by 6 delta x cube d3 phi dx cube at I plus higher order terms. And this I can now use to approximate my so this should actually be d phi dx, so now I can approximate my first derivative by bringing all quantities to the left hand side. So now we can write d phi dx at location I using forward differencing to be 4 phi I plus 1 minus phi I plus 2 minus 3 phi I by 2 delta x with truncation error of order delta x square. So what I've shown you here is that by taking an additional point, which was I plus 2 here, I was able to derive a higher order approximation for the first derivative. Now it's fairly easy to see that if I take I plus 3, I can actually derive a third order expression for the first derivative. So similar treatment can be applied to obtain higher order derivatives or higher order second derivatives as well. So not just limited to 2, but even 3 and 4 and so on. All right, the last thing I want to say in this lecture is that there is one key feature of identifying whether the scheme that you derived is actually consistent. Now the consistency comes in, consider in this case that if phi was a constant, in which case d phi dx will be 0. Analytically d phi dx will be 0. But what should it lead to? So if phi was a constant, technically at all grid locations phi will be constant. So the only way that would be consistent with our approximation for the derivative would be, if I look at phi constant here, we get phi, let's say phi is some c. So we get 4c minus c minus 3c, so that sums to 0. Which means that the coefficients that we get of any finite difference approximation, the coefficients should actually add up to 0. And now you can verify, so it adds up to 0 here, 4 minus 1 minus 3 is 0. If I look at the older expressions, we had 1 minus 2 plus 1, which again goes to 0. And finally, if I look at this, the backward difference again, we have 1 minus 1 which is 0 and 1 minus 1 which is 0. So that's an important point for you to remember when you are verifying whether your finite difference approximations are correct or not.